Well, I have the honor now of introducing our next speaker, and perhaps there's a few people here who really don't know who Jack Foy is, but there's got to be very few by now. But he's not only famous because he served in the 87th Division, which he will tell you was in Patton's Third Army. He's famous because of his love and his care for this community and the love of his fellow veterans that he worked so hard all of these years to put on these ceremonies, and he's worked very hard to put on this last one. So without further ado, Mr. Jack Foy.
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, fellow veterans, we, the veterans of the Battle of the Bulge, come before you today for the last time. Dick Brookins and a couple others of us called our first meeting together on December the 16th, 1998. We very rapidly grew to 99 members. Since then, of course, nature has taken its toll. Our membership has gradually diminished over the years. I now have 5 veterans on my roster: Max Badalkin, Marty Coco, Bill Cooper, Joe Versage, and myself. We are all well up in our 90s. Bill Cooper, our oldest member, he's over 100 years old, and right now he's in hospice, fighting to make it to 101. All 5 of us were frontline infantrymen, and we all had pretty much the same experiences. Let me take you back 74 years. I am an infantry machine gunner, part of General George Patton's Third Army. We are in a foxhole just outside of Bastogne, Belgium, in what became known as the Battle of the Bulge. We are fighting to relieve the 101st Airborne Division, which was surrounded in Bastogne by a ring of German steel, the German Army. We're just getting ready to jump off in an attack on a strong German position. The temperature is about 10 below zero, a couple of feet of snow on the ground, and German artillery is blasting our position. The ground is heaving up and down with the violence of the explosions. Trees are splintering and crashing to the ground. The shrapnel is slicing into soldiers' flesh. Rifle and machine gun fire splits the air. The sound is deafening and overwhelming. We are the machine gun section of what is left of an infantry company of the 87th Infantry Division, part of General George Patton's Third Army. Young men, hardly more than boys, most of us 18, 19, 20 years old. Alongside of me was a good friend that I had trained with for over a year, Harvey Wilson. Harvey was very quiet because Harvey was dead. He was feeding ammunition into my machine gun when a German bullet took him. The real story of the Battle of the Bulge is the story of these soldiers and the intense combat action of the small units, the squads, platoons, and companies, and the soldiers who filled their ranks. The Battle of the Bulge started in the early morning of December the 16th, 1944, when 3 German armies, about 500,000 men, attacked what was basically 4 American divisions, about 50,000 men, in the Ardennes area of Belgium and Luxembourg. These units were outnumbered more than 10 to 1 by the massive German assault. The weather was ideal from the German point of view, snow and fog. The American Air Force was useless. The early morning stillness of the fog-shrouded forest was suddenly shattered with a thunderclap of a massive artillery barrage landing on the Americans. The onslaught had begun. They were dry mouthed, and their guts churned with fear as masses of German troopers dressed in greatcoats emerged through the veil of the early morning fog and mist and charged toward us like men possessed. Low in their foxholes, the GIs prayed to the Lord and opened fire with their rifles and machine guns at the overwhelming Nazi assault. We knew that feeling of utter exhaustion, the inability of a soldier's flesh and blood to continue on, yet we must continue or die. We knew firsthand the violent pounding of the heart, the cold sweat, the trembling of the body, and the stark terror that mortal combat brings. It was a hell that had to be endured, and we endured it. There's no way to convey to you the terror and agony of frontline infantry combat, seeing your friends blown to bits, then get ready for the Nazi tank and infantry attack you know is coming. Living through an artillery barrage is an unimaginable horror. Dozens of German shells raining down on us, and there's nothing you can do but hug the ground, pray, and bear it. The frontline infantryman's concern is with death, not life, with destruction, not construction. The ultimate destruction is killing another human being, and that's something that we had to do almost every day. Even nature was our enemy, with bitterly cold, often 10 below zero weather. The ground was frozen solid, the skies were gray, the days were short with daylight at 8 and darkness by 4. The nights were long and frigid, and snow knee-deep covered the battlefield. GIs, their bodies numb, were blue-lipped and chilled to the bone. Only a very few of us had proper winter clothing. Frozen feet were a big problem. We were outside in the zero weather 24 hours a day, day after day. Nights ranged from 0 degrees to 10 below and even lower. Men without shelter either stayed awake stomping their feet through the long night or might be able to get a few minutes sleep in a foxhole wrapped in a blanket. When the tips were down and the situation was desperate, the American soldiers stood up to be counted. For a brief moment in history, these men held our nation's destiny in their hands. We did not fail. The assault pushed the defending Americans back, but he made the Germans pay dearly for the ground that they gained. Not able to stop the powerful German advance, we really slowed it down. Our army suffered an average of 500 men killed and 1,000 men wounded every day for the over the 6 weeks as the Bulge lasted. 500 men killed and 1,000 wounded every day. And that was just in the Bulge area, not the rest of Europe and the Pacific. The fighting sometimes got down to hand with knives, pistols, and bayonets. This type of fighting was completely different from what we were used to, shooting a man with a rifle or a machine gun 20, 50, 100 yards away was one thing. But sticking a knife in a Nazi or shooting him from a couple of feet away and having his blood spatter on you was completely different. You knew that you had killed or wounded a real man, not just some object a distance away that could be rather impersonal. Over 7 decades have passed since those terrible days when we endured the mud of the Tsar, the bitter cold, snow, and ice of the Ardennes, the dank cellars along the Rhine River, the terrible artillery barrages, the constant fighting and killing. We were miserable and cold and exhausted, and most of the time we were scared to death. But we were young and strong then, possessing the marvelous resilience of youth. And for all the misery and fear and hating every moment of it, the war was a great, if always terrifying, adventure. Not a man among us would want to go through it again, but we are all proud to have been so severely tested and found adequate. When we left the Bulge, I left many friends there. Our machine gun section, which started with 12 men, was now down to 4. We had 5 killed and 3 badly wounded. Our company was badly decimated, down to about 40, 50 men left from 200. The war in Europe ended May the 8th, 1945, over 74 years ago. The war may have ended 74 years ago, but for us, the soldiers who fought in that war, and the families of those who died in that conflict, it will never end. There is a closeness and a special bond between men who have faced death together in combat that is impossible to explain. The Ardennes woods are silent now. The battle smoke has fled. 70 years and two have passed. Now only memories in the dead. Thank you. May God bless you. May God bless America.
Please remain standing. We're going to furl our colors one last time. And I want to introduce our color guard, both Vietnam veterans, Dick Rebin, 173rd Airborne Brigade, and Ron Cunningham, 12th Cavalry Regiment, 1st Cavalry Division.